For the last several weeks, and years for that matter, many in the Republican establishment here in Washington fed and nurtured a monster that was growing in their midst. Conspiracy theories, white supremacy, nationalism, violent political rhetoric, and the bastardization of the Constitution. They tried to harness the power of this monster, insisting that it wasn't actually a monster at all, as if our eyes were just deceiving us, even as the monster grew out of control in clear view. Well, yesterday, that monster overcame those Republicans. Trump supporters stormed the Capitol. They injured several police officers. They threatened the safety of the vice president and the entire Senate and the entire House, as well as the thousands of staffers and journalists who worked there, while Congress was certifying Joe Biden's Electoral College win. Four people died. The Capitol Police say an officer shot one woman as protesters were seen on video attempting to break a door down inside the building, and police are investigating that. And now many Republicans are trying to rewrite history to cover their asses, like Senator Josh Hawley, one of the ringleaders of this coup attempt. Missouri's junior senator became the first to object to Joe Biden's win. His basis for doing so? Lies and conspiracy theories. Shortly before the attack, he appeared for a photo op for his expected 2024 run for president, raising a fist outside the Capitol to Trump supporters there. There he is. The same Senator Hawley who the night before appeared on Fox to say how furious he was that liberal protesters showed up outside of his home with bullhorns.
This Antifa group now says, oh, it was a candlelight vigil. We were singing songs, you know, like it's a church choir or something, with bullhorns, you know, screaming at my wife, demanding, come out, pounding on our door. This is unbelievable. The bottom line is, Laura, nobody should have this happen to them. If it can happen to my family, it can happen to any family in America.
Now, he tweeted that, quote, we're not going to sit back and take it. And you can imagine how upsetting it would be to have protesters show up at your house, right? He said he wasn't home, but his wife was with their newborn and she was shaken. But during the siege on the Capitol, Hawley blasted out a fundraising appeal to supporters. And then after the attack, he continued his attempt to overturn a Democratic election, going on his merry way, like an attack on the Capitol that made the protest at his house look quaint didn't just happen.
This is the place where those objections are to be heard and dealt with, debated, and finally resolved in this lawful means, peacefully, without violence, without attacks, without bullets. And so, Mr. President, let me just say now briefly, in lieu of speaking about it later, a word about Pennsylvania.
Senator Ted Cruz, another architect of the coup attempt, he stood before a crowd in Georgia over the weekend and said this.
I am inspired. Each of you look around, the men and women that are gathered here, you are patriots, just like the patriots gathered at Bunker Hill, just like the patriots gathered at Valley Forge, just like the patriots who forged this nation. The men and women gathered here and across the state of Georgia are fighting for the United States of America.
Bunker Hill, Valley Forge, fighting for the fate of the United States of America. When domestic terrorists were inspired to storm the Capitol like a scene out of Braveheart, here's how they explained it to CNN's Donnie O'Sullivan and Ellie Reeve.
I'm excited that for 1776, we the people movement is moving forward.
One man I talked to had pushed through the barricades and described the police macing them and him fighting back. And I was like, what's the point? And he said, what's the point? Like, this is our only choice. This is the only option we have. The Supreme Court doesn't have our backs. This is 1776.
Now, where would they have gotten that idea? Maybe from Ted, who me couldn't be Cruz, who made a fundraising pitch during the attack that his office later blamed on an outside firm. Ted Cruz, who said this after the attack.
But I would urge to both sides, perhaps, a bit less certitude and a bit more recognition that we are gathered at a time when democracy is in crisis. Recent polling shows that 39% of Americans believe the election that just occurred, quote, was rigged.
No duh. because leaders like Cruz are spoon-feeding them lies that the election was rigged and urging them to fight the result by comparing the rejection of Joe Biden's win in the year 2020 to opposing British rule during the American Revolutionary War. Then there's outgoing Senator Kelly Loeffler, who just the night before lost her runoff election against Senator-elect Raphael Warnock. She, too, was objecting to Joe Biden's win, planning to challenge it on the Senate floor. But after the attack, she backed off.
I cannot now in good conscience object to the certification of these electors.
24 hours earlier, when she still had a political future, she fueled the opposition to Biden's win.
On January 6th, I will object to the Electoral College vote.
And then there is Senator Lindsey Graham, one of the president's most famous apologists and enablers. Here he is speaking on the floor after the attack.
From my point of view, he's been a consequential president. But today, first thing you'll see, all I can say is count me out. Enough is enough. I've tried to be helpful.
He's out, huh? 13 days to go in the Trump administration, and now enough is enough? When the monster that he helped create threatened his life. But hold up, wait a minute, because as Lindsey Graham came to Jesus on the extent to which he would endure this non-presidential behavior from the president yesterday, he also tried to rewrite history, lambasting voter fraud claims from the Trump campaign.
They say there's 66,000 people in Georgia under 18 voted. How many people believe that? I asked, give me 10. I hadn't had one. They said 8,000 felons in prison in Arizona voted. Give me 10. I hadn't gotten one.
That would be commendable from a senator who had not allegedly called up Georgia's Republican Secretary of State to pressure him to find ways to exclude or invalidate legally cast absentee ballots in an attempt to reverse Trump's loss in Georgia. Now, that claim from the state's Republican Secretary of State sparked an ethics complaint, but Graham says the claim is ridiculous and he just wanted to know more about signature verification. And then there's the conspiracy theory that is out there right now in right-wing circles that it wasn't actually Trump supporters who perpetrated this attack. Yeah, that is what is being talked about in right-wing media right now. And they're getting an assist from some of the most powerful Republican lawmakers in Washington as they try to blame liberal extremists for the failed coup at the Capitol.
People came here to do some damage. I don't know who they're with, but they came here to do some damage.
We knew this big crowd was coming, right? We knew they were coming. We knew, you know, whether Antifa was in there or not, we'll find out more.
That was the House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy breathing life into the conspiracy theory that this was a false flag operation. Leftists pretending to be Trump supporters storming the Capitol, even though it was the president who summoned these crowds to D.C., who spoke at their rally, who offered to walk them over to the Capitol and then defended them after the attack. Many of the people shown in video entering the Capitol were Trump supporters who appear publicly a lot, which makes them easily identifiable. The guy with the horns and the hat with the fur who got to the Senate floor, that is a known QAnon conspiracy theorist and Trump supporter. Capitol Police released his photo. They say that he's a person of interest that they want to talk to as part of their probe. Then this guy in Nancy Pelosi's office with his feet up on her desk is a Trump supporter who leads a gun rights group in Arkansas. And there are so many others. One of the most well-known conservative activists who is critical of Antifa told the right-leaning Washington Examiner that the perpetrators did not look like Antifa, and he didn't think Antifa was capable of organizing on that scale, and that there had been no chatter about Antifa's involvement, which there would be if they were involved. But sure, Leader McCarthy and Fox, Antifa. Next, there's Senator James Lankford. He's a Trump loyalist among the senators who were planning to object. In fact, he was on the floor speaking when the Senate was evacuated. But after the siege, he backpedaled, saying this.
In Oklahoma, we'd say something like, why in God's name would someone think attacking law enforcement and occupying the United States Capitol is the best way to show that you're right? Why would you do that?
Why, Senator, would they do that? If you weren't paying attention to what was happening in Washington yesterday morning, if you were willfully ignorant of what was going on just down Pennsylvania Avenue, of the huge gatherings that were making travel to and from the Capitol, where Senator Lankford was difficult, it might be a decent question. Not far from the Hill, the president's lawyer was saying this to the angry crowd just before their attack.
And if we're wrong, we will be made fools of. But if we're right, a lot of them will go to jail. So, let's have trial by combat.
This morning, Giuliani tried acting like he is stunned by what happened, called the riot shameful, criminal, and he tried to play whataboutism with liberals, his logic melting as quickly as sprayed on hair on a warm day in Philadelphia. But his client, the president, was of course the chief instigator here. He called them to Washington to demonstrate. He spoke at the rally knowing that he was appearing before a crowd that included a large contingent of white supremacists and extremists. He had lied to his supporters for years. And as he told them to move on the Capitol, he told them another lie, that he would be going with them.
And after this, we're going to walk down and I'll be there with you. We're going to walk down. We're going to walk down anyone you want, but I think right here, we're going to walk down to the Capitol. And we're going to cheer on our brave senators and congressmen and women. And we're probably not going to be cheering so much for some of them. Because you'll never take back our country with weakness. You have to show strength and you have to be strong.
He said, quote, I will be there with you. He said those words in front of a bulletproof piece of glass. He told his supporters to, quote, fight like hell to overturn an election. And then, as Trump's army of supporters marched to Capitol Hill to confront his enemies, Trump got back in his hermetically sealed armored limousine, and he drove literally in the opposite direction, returning to the safety of the White House, where he watched it all go down on TV. White House staffers who probably thought that they had seen it all by this point were visibly shaken by President Trump's response, according to CNN's Caitlin Collins. Trump was, quote, borderline enthusiastic over the siege of the Capitol, and he didn't want to condemn the perpetrators, according to multiple sources. Trump's Republican enablers, they have blood on their hands, and they want to pretend they had no idea this could happen. They seem baffled that the monster they nurtured and stroked turned on them. They've sold their souls. For what? For ambition. And they act like they don't know that when you sell your soul, at some point, there is a debt to settle.